Very good evening, sir. Thanks for joining us over a video interview. So how are you doing? How is the situation with COVID there in the campus?
So till now, we have been able to manage it reasonably well. And there have been frequent notifications from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and different government departments, and we are trying to conform to the notifications. In the campus, we have a hospital. Mm-hmm. So that hospital was stretched to some extent because anybody with a travel advisory, he or she has to make sure that they report at the hospital. And also based on travel advisory, we were quarantining members of the community. Even though they did not have any symptoms. And once they completed the quarantine period, then off.
Right.
There's been no case till now.
Great.
And we hope that it continues that way.
But yes, that's really good. You guys are already prepared in the hospital, in the campus. So yeah, that's good enough. So if we talk about education, we all know it's at the verge of there's so much distraction. If we see the regular classes has been pending since long. I hope you are routinely will be using virtual classes for them.
Yeah.
Yeah. But what about practical curriculum? How you have planned to cope up once the college starts?
So, first we are trying to make sure that these virtual classes, or what we are calling it as the teaching learning process over the internet. Mm-hmm. We want to make sure that the best practices that are available, and they are sort of widely, people are made aware of it. And depending on the requirement of different courses, whichever suits best, that is adopted. Mm-hmm. So the focus has been that that these virtual classes be made as effective as possible. Because it needs an extra initiative and extra effort on the side of both students as well as faculty.
Right.
Because both sides are used to conventional blackboard teaching. Hmm. Or even the PowerPoint presentations that happen in the class. But then this has to move out to an experience which is virtual, which is online. And so we want to make sure that we understand the nuances involved there so that the teaching becomes effective.
Right.
So the present goal is that how much we can replicate the classroom experience so that it is as close to the classroom as possible. Once we resume the semester, in the sense that once we allow the students to come back, semester is already on because teaching is going on. Mm-hmm. But once we allow the students to come back, then we are hoping that the situation will give us enough time so that we can conduct laboratory sessions. Mm-hmm. And so as of now, we are not planning to do labs over the internet. But we'll make sure that some time is available to the students. And we are hoping that the situation will normalize sooner rather than later. And that we will get time for be able to, so that we can do this.
Right. So one of my question after this will be, if we all know it's very uncertain when lockdown will open, it's completely totally depends on the situation. So in your opinion, if this extend maybe to a month or a 2 month session, then how we are going to cope up with this? Are you planning to extend the exam thing? Because yes, practicals are essential, especially when we talk about technical education. So what solution you have in your mind? What you have planned?
See, in some sense, the outbreak of COVID-19 has been at a good time. Good time in the sense that it is always bad. Not it should never have happened. But the timing is in the sense that we have a buffer of the summer vacation, the usual summer vacation.
Right.
We are in a semester-based system. If this would have happened in the previous semester, then the buffer is much shorter.
Right.
But this time we have a very sizable buffer available. And we are hoping that that buffer will be effectively used. so that the spillover is not beyond into the next semester.
Mm-hmm.
So that is what we are hoping. And as of now, it looks like it should be possible. Even if the government goes for a 2-week more lockdown,
mm-hmm.
and after, suppose a month after that, the students are allowed to return to the campus,
mm-hmm.
then we will have, June, we'll have teaching and some, and then exams.
Right.
And as usual, we can open towards the last week of July, or maybe 1 or 2 weeks of shift in the next semester can be
mm-hmm.
sort of given if required.
Great, great. So summer vacation, I hope, will give advantages to coping up with all the practicals and all those missing classes. It will act as a good buffer for all education, all institutes in the India.
We are not planning to compensate for all the classes because online education is happening.
Mm-hmm.
So only a few doubt clearing sessions or tutorials or important concepts, those kinds of things can be done.
Right.
So the teaching required, whatever was the gap in the number of classes missed, we are not going to substitute them by exact same number of classes. The number of classes now means much less.
Right. So everything has its, every coin has its own side, if we see. So obviously lockdown has two. So in your opinion, what are the positive aspects of having COVID-19 as we have shifted to virtual classrooms? How are you seeing it?
See, people who have been in the higher education sector have for long been aware that there is a limit beyond which brick and mortar universities will not be possible. It is not only a question of funding, but also in terms of resources, whether it is teachers, whether it is good infrastructure creation. All these constraints are there, and so we can create a few more good institutes, but that number cannot be scaled up indefinitely.
Right.
On the other hand, given the youth of the country, we know that in our country a sizable number of population is in the youth category. They are yearning for good quality education. And so these platforms, whether it was NPTEL, whether it is SWAM, whether it is Swayam Prabha, all these kinds of initiatives have been designed so that more and more teaching can be given to a larger number of students can access the teaching without actually physically attending a university.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that sense, I see this, yes, that we all have to come out of our comfort zones. We are forced to come out of our comfort zones. And the more we try and experiment with this online teaching, we are realizing that, yes, there are ways in which it can be done quite well. Some things work, some things don't work.
Right.
And as I say that, it also depends on the size of the class, composition of the class, whether it is UG, whether it is PG, whether it's a discussion-oriented course, or whether it's more like a theory course, simulation. All those kinds of varieties are there. But because we are now forced to be in a situation where we have to somehow complete the semester.
Right.
So we have taken up this kind of mode of teaching. And we are hoping that in the long run, this will actually answer the question that we have been trying to answer in the last decade.
Right. Very true, sir. I hope after this, college will outgrow themselves. Yeah, we can conduct virtual classroom. It's not impossible. Professor might have those skills afterwards. Because yes, everywhere, every institute is using virtual classrooms now. It's necessity for the time. So that's great. So do you think after this, there will be a revolution in higher education sector? There will be, we can call it a new era after the opening of the lockdown. Yes, everyone is quite much settled with virtual classrooms and having online sessions, online doubt sessions. So what's your take about it?
I would say that it is slightly early to say that.
Mm-hmm.
We will review the situation. We will take the feedback from all stakeholders, students, faculty. We will see that what are the gaps and how to fill those gaps. But I can definitely say that, yes, there is a possibility that it can be a major turning point in the education of the country. It has the potential. Whether it will pan out that way or not, that I think it's too early to say.
Right, right. Very good, sir. Because I think, I'm really hoping we need to shift Indian education to a different domain. As if we see other education systems in the world, they are already using this edtech, what we called as edtech in these days. Yes, so they are using technology in their own education system. They are using virtual labs, as you earlier said. It's there, but it's not so well developed in India. So let's hope maybe in the coming future, we will work upon it. And if any situation like this comes up, or if not, also we can want suggestions, or maybe you can say a message to all other institutes out in India, higher education institutes. How to take this time as a new opportunity, and what do you feel they should feel in this time, and they should not panic about?
Yeah, actually, there is a responsibility upon the teaching community that we try and do the minimum disturbance to the academic calendar. And because of that reason, teachers are willingly taking it up because they know that unless we do this kind of teaching, it will mean that the academic calendar will be disturbed, and maybe disturbed in a major way. And I can say that IITs are quite conscious to make sure that the academic calendar doesn't get disturbed. Right. So in that sense, I would say that the teachers are definitely making the efforts, but I would also say that let us not look only at the teachers. Mm-hmm. No teaching, effective teaching can happen unless students also participate.
Very true.
After all, what is the classroom? The classroom consists of both the teacher and the student. So students also have to come forward and go the extra mile so that they do not hesitate in participations. They are willing to write their queries. They are willing to ask queries in the online sessions. They shed their hesitation. They should come out of their comfort zone that this is not a classroom, but can I still in my mind think that this is a classroom? And if the students come forward, then it further reinforces the confidence of the teacher.
Right.
So it's a two-way thing. Any one party alone will have difficulty in making the complete transition to be successful. But if both parties take small steps, the other party is encouraged to take more steps.
Right. Some of our teachers, I was talking about, we had a very good discussion about this. So what major problem teachers are facing is, yes, students are somehow not accepting things. They are panicking. They are not accepting virtual classroom as if. So what tips you will give to teachers how to handle such a big classroom virtually? Yes, they are facing a big challenge.
Right, right. So the first and foremost thing I would say is that we must initially keep the pace very slow.
Okay.
I think whatever the teachers were doing in the 1 hour class, they should not necessarily try to force that much material in the first, second, third initial set of virtual classes. We have to make sure that the pace, especially in the initial part, is very slow. Once the pace is slow, we'll have more and more students on board. Mm-hmm. So that is the most important key. In fact, in IIT Roorkee, we have actually acknowledged this, that the pace of the instruction will be slightly slower. Mm-hmm. And that is why we need probably more number of longer duration of the online teaching to be able to do that, because students have to come on board and students have to feel comfortable. So if the teaching pace is at a speed at which the students are able to absorb it, then I think the pleasure will increase on both sides. Okay. Students will start enjoying, teacher will start enjoying, and we'll be coming closer and closer to the real classroom experience.
Right. Any kind of suggestion you want to give to professors or you must be implementing in your college to motivate students to accept virtual classrooms? to make them more comfortable? Yes, one of the tips you just suggested to take this on a slow pace. But other than that, how we can motivate? Because what I'm observing is professors are really in a big strain these days. It's a big pressure on them also.
True. You are right. So what I would say, the second thing I would say is that if you convey to the students that this is here, this is going to stay. This is not something that will vanish in a week or 2 weeks, right? And the concepts or the subjects that we are teaching, we will not get time in the physical classroom to be able to do that. So that seriousness, if it is conveyed to the student, that this is the time we have to put our efforts so that we do this learning, we do this teaching, and we will not get enough time in the physical classroom. So let us do that, because this course is not going to be taught again to you. These topics are not going to be taught again to you.
Right.
So let us not panic. Let us both sides try and make efforts. And as I said, keep the pace low, especially in the beginning. Once the comfort level is fine, then the pace can be increased or brought to the normal rate.
Right.
And it also depends on the size of the class. So that is a big factor in the sense that how to interact and how to engage the students. Mm-hmm. So engaging the students is very important.
Well, for the best, let's... time passes on, and with the next semester, we hope we'll have the normal classes again.
Right.
See. So what do you think of EduWise as an initiative?
So, we need good journalism. We need a good set of people to look at the whatever is happening in the education world, higher education world, from the outside, and get a understanding of what is happening and how it is growing and what is becoming better or what is going down in case it is happening. So in that sense, yes, we need many such initiatives. EduVoice is one of them, and I hope that it will grow with time.